Alright, I'm gonna take a look at this game that I downloaded off GitHub. It's not really impressive, it's definitely got a glitch in it. You can see you got a cannon object here, and I guess you're supposed to shoot these red things because it increases the score when you do, if you can tell in the upper, you know. But see, it's got a glitch, you know. After you shoot a bunch of them, they disappear, but you know, anyway, I got a score of 10 anyway, for what that's worth. The only way to stop it, too, is by stopping it here in the, you know, stop debugging. Anyway, I'm going to look at this thing and dissect it. For what I know, again, I still haven't been able to learn a whole hell of a lot about C sharp, really, because it's, you know, trying to figure this shit out just from stuff out on the internet, like YouTube videos and everything else, kind of like herding cats. I mean, it's just really, it's just all over the fucking place, and, you know, there's no structured approach to it that's not taught in Windows, you know, as a fucking console application, which is totally useless in a visual language. I mean, that doesn't make sense at all. Again, I said this before, but like I said, in C++, it made a little sense to learn console programming because of its applicability to a lot of different applications, including embedded systems programming, which would be console-like. Okay, but here, you know, dude, C-sharp is Windows and only Windows. It's a Windows creation. It's a Microsoft creation, and because of that, it's only a visual programming language. It should only be taught visually. There's really no good use of a goddamn console. You know, you're totally wasting your time trying to learn, you know, programming in a console when you could be learning it in a, as a forms application or even a, you know, fucking XAML, you know, WPF, whatever, you know, would be better than a console. And it's just a total waste of fucking time. But at any rate, I need to go buy some books on C#. You know, that's the only way to really actually kind of get a good structured view of it. Because, you know, I could learn C# this way, but it'd take like 3 months, you know, trying to piece it all together on my own. Whereas I could just, you know, buy a few books and, you know, look at it and see some actual code, too. That's what's frustrating, is trying to find example code. Because Microsoft has no goddamn samples in this whatsoever, and most of the samples from Microsoft or whatever don't work. So, you know, there's just nothing to really go on. But anyway, I'm going to take a look at this, you know, and this guy, you know, in my opinion, is underutilizing classes, you know, at least from, you know, what I learned at C++. You know, his classes are mostly a little more than structures. So, you know, like this, for example, it's really just a structure. You know, he's got a constructor in it, but it really is only holding two variables. So, it's got a constructor which initializes them, but, you know, that's it. You know, and that's for the blocks. I guess that's for the green things you saw on the screen there. And then he's got a bullet class here, which is a little more involved. And he's using, you know, threading and so forth. And again, I don't know much about that or why he would want to use threading in this application. I mean, maybe there's a good reason for it. I don't know. Because I still haven't done much in the way of video games and C#, forms applications, you know, which is what this is, the WinForm application. And you can see his form here. It's just a generic empty form. Not much on it. Nothing on it, really. But, you know, this bullet class of his, you know, this is the constructor for it. He's got some member variables here. One's a boolean, you know, which is probably representing the lifespan of the bullet, and then X, Y position for it, and a DPS, dots per second. I don't know. There's very, very, very little, you know, this is one of the few comments he's got in here. That's what I don't like about looking at programs from, you know, I guess people that are new to coding or whatever, is that they don't comment their code a lot. So, you know, you're looking at, you know, programs that don't really have a lot of explanation what the fuck's going on, so you just gotta do the best. But at least this is pretty simple. So I can kind of understand it a little bit, but like I said, this threading stuff, I don't know anything about. so, or why he's creating these in separate threads. I you know, like I said, there might be a good reason for it, but I don't know. I mean, I don't know what the advantage is, except that it might be, you know, it's just another way of, you know, if you kind of look at the code here, like thread.sleep, you know, that implies that this thread, because he's doing this in a while loop, so while alive, you know, it's going to run this thread, you know, until it's not alive anymore, you know, but if it's less than or equal to 600, which I assume is the vertical resolution of the screen, it'll kill the bullet and kill the thread with it, I suppose. So, although I'm not really quite sure where that happens, and probably not here, because this object here is actually instantiated in this canon object over here, and you'll see that in a second. But this seems to be handling its own flight trajectory, you know, which is good, you know, that's at least something. You know, because you can see it updating the position of it in systemthread.sleep. So ostensibly that'll put it to sleep and it'll come back after 25 milliseconds or whatever that is, and then rerun this code. It'll pick up the loop until it, you know, is not alive anymore. So I guess that kills the thread, and you can see the, you know, move bullet being referenced here, you know, which is that member method right here. So, you know, that's what it's referencing. Always starting a thread for the move bullet method here, and then starting the thread. So that's all this basically does. Then we can go into the canon object, okay, and here we're instantiating the bullet object as part of an array, you know. So I guess you can have more than one of these on here at once, I suppose. And and I don't know what HP is. See, it's 100, whatever it is. There's a constructor for it, so he's creating a thread for it too. You know, it's got a kill bullet method here and a create bullet method here. So ray dot resize ref bullets. Bullets. See, I don't know much about arrays and array work, but I am curious because that might be relevant. But, you know, there's other ways of managing collections of objects too outside of arrays. That way you don't have to worry about having to dynamically rescale the arrays all the time. You know, like lists or whatever. Again, I'm still trying to figure all that crap out too, but still, you know, this bullet length, bullet dot length, okay, bullet dot length, so it's going to be a member of this, but I don't see a bullet dot length in here. Just being stupid. Bullet dot length. What the fuck? Bullet dot length plus one. Bullets dot length. Yeah, it's bullets dot length. So I don't know what bullets is. Well, bullets is this. So it's, like I said, it's an object, a bullet, but I don't see a dot length member in it. I don't see a length member. Let's see. Alive, not alive. These look like the only member variables here. X and Y and... So where the fuck is bullet.length coming from? Maybe that's... well... huh. Bullet dot length. Bullet dot length, rather. We kill bullet method here. I said it keeps referencing this bullets.length. What the fuck is that? Here, let me try something here. Wow. Did he inherit a bunch of stuff from somewhere else that I didn't notice? See, there's no height. Let's say width. And it's no width either. Okay. Don't know where that's coming from. Yeah, that's course just up there, but where the shit's this coming from? Now this is part of the array, apparently. Okay. Okay, so it's apparently an array issue is what it is. Again, I still don't know much about arrays in C sharp. So that has something to do with the array. Not bullets not live. Constructor is called. If bullets.live's not true, okay, 0 to bullets.length, and it must be the array length is what it must be, I don't know. It gets a 32-bit integer that represents the total number of elements and all the dimensions. Yeah, it is. It's just a length of an array. That's what it is. Okay. I'm still getting used to this whole .NET thing, because that still really confuses me quite a bit. You know, how almost everything on here, including types, actually is an object. So, you know, because in C or C++, you know, that wouldn't be the case. You know, those arrays are not objects. You know, the pointers, but. Now, here we don't have pointers per se. I mean, we apparently do, and you can use them. You know, if you put it, you know, classify something as unsafe. you know, so you can say like public, you know, class public unsafe or whatever. Then you can use pointers in it apparently. And at least it has similar syntax to C++ when you do that. But, okay, but at any rate, we're, you know, going through every element, you know, of this array, you know, every bullet, you know, and checking if it's alive, I suppose. You know, if it's marked as alive, and if it's not, you know, it'll resize the array to, you know, slightly smaller, so it kills off the bullets. And I guess this is assuming that the first bullet to be killed off is, you know, going to be the first one created, so. Otherwise, you'd be killing off other bullets in flight. You know, that could create a problem, if that's what's going on. Maybe that's why that thing keeps zonking out on me. But, anyway, so you can kind of see what's going on with this a little bit. Create bullet. Okay, so he's increasing the length of the array. You know, and it's, I think this is the, you know, equivalent to the ampersand and C, if I'm not mistaken. You know, so so in other words, that's the C sharp version of the ampersand. You know, the reference symbol. So it's passing a reference front to the bullets object. You know, instantiation of it, bullets array, really, I guess, into the this array dot resize. So, you know, because he's calling that as a generic array, you know. And again, that's one of the things that gets confusing to me about it, you know, because we're actually dealing with a type, a function of the generic base type or whatever, and we're calling it like this to resize the array. But that's why we had to pass it in a specific instance of the array, because it's generic. So, and it's increasing the array size here, so the create bullet method, and bullets, you know, bullet.length minus one, now equals new bullet. So he's instantiating a new bullet and calling its constructor with an x and y position, which I guess is defined up here or wherever. I mean, that's actually a member variable, so if it's been altered, then fine. Okay. Let's see. Anyway, I thought this was worth going through because it's still pretty simple use of classes. And again, C Sharp's classes are just, you know, the class syntax is just so different than C. I mean, I really prefer C++ quite a bit. But then again, I don't know. You know, I'm kind of thinking that this philosophy, because, you know, might be better, you know, having all your code in one place. Because, you know, in C++, normally, you know, you have your header files and your, you know, in your class files, you're seeing a CPP, you know, the actual functions are, will be in a CPP file, or at least outside of the, you know, the declaration of the class anyway. You know, you normally don't put your functions actually in the class, but really that's probably not necessary, you know, when you got things like IntelliSense, because IntelliSense, you know, I mean, the reason C++ did that, at least one of them, one of the reasons they did it, you know, was for readability, you know, so you can see how you're, you know, easily see what the interface to your class is. But the thing is, with IntelliSense, you can see what the interface of your class is just by typing, you know, a dot, okay, and that makes a lot of sense. So, you know, you probably don't need that anymore, although I still wondered how, you know, that'll affect code reuse and everything, but still, you know, again, still learning. Okay, but, you know, anyway, we've got this enemy object, which, again, this is a little more than a structure. So, you know, same with the blocks. I mean, it's a little more than a structure. But, like I said, the bullet, you know, class has is multiply instantiated in the canon class. Again, I'd be tempted, you know, if I were doing this in C++, to actually make the bullet class a nested class of canon, maybe, but maybe not. But, you know, it'd be kind of tempting anyway. But he also has this power-ups thing, which I don't know what the fuck these are. This is another class. This dot type equals this dot type. He's having to use this operator to clear up the, you know, the ambiguity, since he's using the same names for, you know, both variables input to the constructor and his member variables. Again, that's bad practice, you know. let's see. You know, that's a pretty simple class, and then here's just our program. That's the main application right here. So, you know, if we go look at the, you know, the form, you know, this is where he puts all of his code. And again, I really wouldn't have done this. I think this is, you know, not a very good use of object-oriented programming. I would have put most of this code actually in the objects themselves, but we'll talk about that in a second. He's got a form one paint event here, which, you know, this seems to draw all the objects. Not quite clear when this is painted. That's why I don't know. I'm wondering if he's using threading, you know, because to avoid having to do a like a screen redraw, or if he's just using, you know, the Windows form to do it. I don't know how he's doing it yet. You know, fill rectangle, fill rectangle, you know. So again, this basically draws all the different objects, enemies dot length, blocks dot length. Interesting. Okay, so yeah, he's going through any instantiations he might have in those arrays, I suppose. Cannons dot length. Again, even these draw events, I would have been inclined to put in the classes themselves, but you know, you'd have to pass some kind of a handle to the form, you know, the form object, you know, to your classes to do it. But I mean, you know, I would have had a pain event that simply calls all the draw methods and, you know, in the individual elements, you know, like we'd have a blocks element, that makes sense, a bullets element, you know, fine. And a cannon, I guess that's the you know, pretty much the viewer or the user, and then an enemy, you know, and then power ups, whatever the fuck those are. But again, I would have put, you know, all the draw, you know, each of these would have a draw function in it, and basically that encapsulated, but you'd have to pass it, you know, a handle, you know, the object sender or whatnot, into your functions, you know, but clear up all the code out of here, because again, you know, these in object-oriented programming, you know, these objects really should encapsulate as much functionality, you know, to, in other words, be as object-like as they can, and that includes, you know, potentially having their own drawing functions. Again, you deal with it out in main code, you know, but only in the sense of calling the draw functions, but then if you needed to interact with anything, again, the main code kind of handles that for any special circumstances. But then we got a form load event, you know, where he's setting a bunch of threads again. Not quite sure why. Let's see what he's doing with it. You know, simulate game, spawn enemies, spawn blocks. Okay, so spawn power up. So okay, well, that's commented out. That's probably why we don't have power ups in there. you know, here's a spawn power ups function. So, you know, setting that to sleep for like 20 seconds, I suppose. Assuming that's in milliseconds. But we got spawn blocks. Okay, it says while run. So run must be some kind of a... Yeah, here we go. Run equals true. Okay. Setting the score to 0. So there's a score object, or a score member. Spawn some kind of power up there, which I guess you gotta run over those. So then a random object. Power ups, blocks. Okay, so blocks are, you know, enemies appear every 5 seconds, blocks every 5 seconds. I'm going to change that to 8 seconds. Go ahead and comment out this code too, so the next time I run it, I'm going to try to see what's going on with it. Let's see what that does. Okay. Well, and that's why he got rid of it. Well, that stopped pretty quickly. Try it again. Seconds or so, there should be a... I'm almost reluctant to shoot any of these things. Score 10. Now I don't see any power-ups showing up, whatever the hell those are supposed to be. guess I could, you know, get carried away now. Got a lot of these assholes lined up in a row. Okay. Yeah. Anyway. But yeah, so yeah, I'm not clear on what power-ups are supposed to be, but I guess I can go ahead and comment it back out, because I don't know what they're for. Okay. Okay, we got a simulate game. Okay, wall run. Check collision. So, you know, these are called, I guess, you know, on each of those thread increments, because like I said, they're set, you know, to in here somewhere, you know, to call every so often, you know, thread.sleep. So it'll run those threads and then sleep, and then I guess come back to it and keep doing that until, you know, the thread goes away, I suppose. I don't know. I guess it just keeps doing this forever. Create power up. So yeah, so basically it's creating these things, you know, every time that thread comes out of sleep, you know, out of its sleep mode. So that's all this does, is just creates the threads. It doesn't really check, do any checks or anything. And then we're simulate game, okay, check collision. And I don't know why he's invalidating the... Okay, so, yeah, that's what I was kind of thinking. Okay, so it's going to be a simulate game thread then. Yeah, right here. So in the simulate game, okay, thread sleeps for about 25 milliseconds. So, you know, every 25 milliseconds it'll run this, and it'll do a collision check, and it invalidates the window, which causes it to be redrawn. So that is how he's doing it. And then this dot text equals, you know, he updates the score, basically. So that happens at a rate of 25 milliseconds.
Yeah.
See, 25 milliseconds. 1 divided by 0.025 equals about 40 frames per second. So that's the frame rate he's basically using here. He's doing a check collision. That's got to be a separate thread, I suppose. I don't know. No, he was running that from down here. Okay, so once every 25 milliseconds, then he'll run the check collision, check block and enemy collision. I mean, I guess you're supposed to be able to run into him. I don't know. I guess you die when you do. I don't know. Let's see what it does. Check block collision. Okay. Bullets, blocks. Okay, it does change the block, so maybe you can run into him, I don't know. I'm not sure if you can actually die in this or not. I guess I could go find out. But yeah, this is just a bounds check, you know, it's checking a bounds between, you know, basically every block, you know, with your cannon. The cannons, the bullets, well, this is checking collisions with your bullets anyway. Okay. Now check enemy collision, so this is probably checking to see if your bullets are colliding with the enemy. So I don't know if you can run into them or not. Enemy killed. Okay. So, in our enemy, do we have anything that keeps track of the number of times it's been shot? Let's just say HP. Don't really have any getter or setter methods here, but. Here's HP referenced here. So HP is decremented, but DPS, damage per, okay, so our bullets, you know, has that DPS function, so it's probably damage per hit would be my guess. I don't know where it's, where DPS is set. You know, it's not in the constructor. So, I would have just missed it somewhere. But I assume that's the damage per shot or whatever, so, so that's probably what it's doing. It's subtracting the damage per shot, you know, from the health of the enemy, and, you know, when it's zero, it kills it, you know. So if, you know, it's less than or equal to zero, enemy is killed, so it increments the score. Okay. And it creates another enemy, so I guess every time when you kill it, it creates a new fucking enemy. Well, that's never going to end, is it? Okay. Now here, you know, this is a key down event. So here's where you're controlling the movement and looking for up and down and left and right arrow keys. And there's got to be a space key in there somewhere, because that's what you use to fire the thing. Where the shit's that at? Key down. That's the limit of his key down event. Okay, power up, you know, doesn't really do anything. Okay, we had a crate block event, our method here. So, crate enemy. Form closing. Threads, I suppose. Just handle exiting better, because there could be a lot of threads taking up your memory if it doesn't close them down right. I might have like 50 of these fucking things running right now until I reboot my computer. I don't know. Okay, here's where the space key. Okay, form one key up. Oh, that's interesting. Okay. Form one key down, okay, so he just uses different events for the, you know, the firing versus the movement. But at any rate, I would have encapsulated all of these movements into the canon object. You know, the canon object would be your player, and that would include the appearance of it and everything, including interfacing the keyboards, you know, because that's still best handled there, you know, as an encapsulated part of that object. you know, and enemy behavior and everything like that. Again, I would have encapsulated, you know, in the object itself, including, maybe even including respawn events, it, or at least the respawn mechanism, so that it could, you know, it'd be called, you know, could be called from the main program, you know, for gameplay purposes, but still the actual process I might have encapsulated in the objects themselves. Again, you know, that makes more sense. That's the whole point of object-oriented programming. But again, I don't know, there may be some reason he did it this way. I don't know enough about C-sharp yet to know how difficult that would be. But again, if you can pass an object by reference, that would be the way to do it. And just pass it the form object, you know, so you can, you know, look at its, you know, a key event occurs. You can pass, you know, that argument, you know, like he uses down here. You just have to pass the arguments into your, you know, into a method inside your object, you know, key event args. So, you know, but your object itself would actually process this code. So it makes your main program a little easier to grapple with, and it puts elements, you know, that you would associate with a given object, you know, in that object, you know, instead of having these objects being so simple. Because, like I said, those are little more than structures. I mean, shit, you could have just declared those here as structures. So, but at any rate, it's just interesting looking at the code. So, anyway, well, actually, before I stop the video, let's try to run it again. I'm going to see what happens if I run into some of those things. Okay. Because I know you can move around the screen all you want. Okay, here's an enemy. Yep, doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. So I guess it just checks your bullets. So I can shoot the things even from the side of it. Die. Yeah, kill them all. That's what you get. Okay, anyway.